Today, I will explain why I believe mobile will change the way we farm and be responsible for the next doubling of productivity on sheep and beef farms in New Zealand and maybe even Australia. And in line with the theme of the conference, I'll talk about change, the challenges, consumers, and the way that we can use mobile to turn it into cash. I'm not going to talk to you about machine-to-machine technology or API or the Internet of Things, but instead just leave mobile at anything that will connect wirelessly or through cellular. This started with my wife and I. I moved home from Sydney to our family farm, 7,000 hectare property, and I left an IT job in Sydney. And when we got home, we'd saved up some money, but we thought we'd better get up a farm advisor. And he came up and I said, what should we do? You know, how should we do this? And he said, well, you should do this and you should do that. But when I asked him about return on investment, he had no way of truly showing me what return I could get from my investment. And I thought, given my background in IT, there must be a better way. So the first thing I did was go and find out what others were doing. So for those that aren't sheep and beef farmers in the room, here's the basics. The 1, 2, 3. The first thing you need to know is that it will cost twice as much and take three times as long. And the second thing is the 3 S: fence, fertilizer, and feed. Once you've done that, it becomes a bit more complicated. You then need to consider genetics, inputs, and management in relation to the environment, and how it affects conception, survivability, growth rate, and eating quality. It's this level of complexity that ensures that very few sheep and beef farmers in New Zealand have a true understanding of their entire business ecosystem, let alone the whole value chain. Beef and Lamb, which is like our Meat and Livestock Australia, did a survey, and they found that 80% of farmers in New Zealand thought they were in the top 20%, which just shows that many think they are doing a better job than they actually are. So for those that are reaching for their phones with boredom, just wait, I've got a few things you might find interesting. What I have identified as the four biggest drivers of change. First, necessity. Whether it's driven by the weather conditions, regulation, farm succession, necessity is a great driver of change. Secondly, financial incentive. We've had a good example of this recently in New Zealand, where some relatively conservative sheep and beef farmers have converted to dairy because the financial incentive has been so great. And although it's not working out because of the milk price just how they thought at the moment, I'm sure it will in time, but what it does show is that people will change if the financial incentive is great enough. The third thing is education, and I'm not talking about the actual extension, but trying to educate people how change will enable them to do what they want. Because if you are able to show them that if the change will enable what they want, they will actually drive to change. And last of all, time. It will happen anyway, with or without you. Things change with time. And if the change outside the farm gate is greater than the change inside the farm gate, then you've really got a problem. The new economy, the shared economy, disruption, are all examples of global change that's happening that has mobile at its heart. Some business examples: M-Pesa, Uber, and WeChat. M-Pesa was launched by Vodafone in 2007 in Kenya. It's a mobile platform which enables you to pay each other using your mobile phone and then cash in your dollars at a designated M-Pesa shop. These are poor and uneducated people, yet within the first year they had 1.2 million users, which was the tipping point for exponential growth, which has led M-Pesa to having over 15 million users and turning over 20% of the GDP of Kenya. And the point I want to make is that people can and will change if the technology enables them. Uber's another example for those that haven't used it or know it. It's like a taxi service, but it's a ride-sharing service. So anyone can become an Uber driver. You just need a driver's license and a background check, but it enables you to use the mobile phone location to not only find out how much your ride is, but also charge it directly to your credit card. So it's another example of disruption. New Zealand has some examples too. Lord, changing pop culture around the globe. The jet boat, the Britain motorcycle, which took on Ducati and won, and of course Gallagher with the electric fence. So my Nuffield, to understand how mobile technology can deliver on-farm and industry productivity gains, and also farmer adoption gaps, and how mobile can help. For this, I travelled the equivalent of 3.8 times around the globe, went to 16 different countries, 14 states of America, hundreds of retailers, over a dozen processing plants, cold storage, but importantly, I went to software companies that aren't currently on a mobile platform, all the major ones that I could find that are doing sheep and beef farming. And the biggest thing that they were trying to overcome was adoption. They were all having problems with adoption. So then why mobile? Mobile is a, finally we have a platform that everyone can use across the value chain, from my mum to my six-year-old son. And more importantly, it's in real time. So you can actually make a decision when you need to make it. It's also able, so once you've got people collecting the data on the farmers, also able to address some other issues we have. Food safety, cultural understanding, online buyer behaviour, traceability, and last of all, transparent supply chains. Although we may need to consider the level of transparency that is appropriate, but at least this guy wasn't a vegetarian. The challenges ahead. Mobile, in a very short space of time, has become part of global life. Many people have actually bypassed other technologies to adopt mobile, like, you know, bypassing the PC, straight to mobile, simply because of its low price, convenience, its ease of use, and their ability to extract value. As we think about this technology for farmers, we must consider these attributes, but also some others that are currently been overlooked. Agriculture, the Latin combination of the word field culture. Farmers must be at the heart of any software application or device for farmers. In the field, considering of those that are using it. Developers must also consider some other things, like user experience, solving simple problems first, return on investment, and like has been mentioned before here, automation. And if we consider all of these things, then we will meet what I have adapted to call the farmer adoption matrix. So how do we then turn this into cash? How do we extract value? Mobile technology can provide opportunities to identify and then make improvements which directly affects total productivity. An example of this, which Hannah actually, that graph that Hannah put up showing the efficiency of the sheep, and is actually where I buy my replacement ewe lambs from. And so he EIDs everything. He's been drafting out the ones, the small ones, which he can't mate in the first year. I'm a high country property, so I can't, it's difficult for me to mate them in the first year. I won't say I'll never do it, but at the moment I can't. So I buy his smaller lambs. But we're able to go back to and identify what those, where those lambs came from. And it turns out that the lambs that he sells me as my replacements are his genetically most advanced. They're his twins from his hoggets and his tutus, which we couldn't do without it. Mobile is also the first platform that links, like I mentioned before, all industry stakeholders, including the farmer, directly to the consumer. If we can deliver practical solutions that has a practical, a tangible gain with a collection of key data, then we're more likely to get the adoption that we need. This will enable more opportunities like predictable procurement and also some really good product outcomes at the other end. There's always farmers that aren't going to adopt this technology though, but if we can show them a constant return, and through influential farmers, which we've heard about throughout the whole conference, if we can use those guys to show them that they don't have to make a huge change to their farming business, just collect some key data to make the decision, then we'll actually get some change that will naturally occur. An example of this happening in New Zealand was the move to crossbreed sheep. Initiated by farmers through necessity, instigated by those farmers and adopted by those that could see that it could change their productivity on their farms. We now have mobile, which will enable to us to concentrate on the individual and not the average, like Hannah mentioned. We don't want to be like, we don't want beef and lamb as a product to be like Blockbuster and Kodak, whose inability to adapt has led to their demise. Nor do we want to be like the UK, who relies on subsidies. But we can't just concentrate on productivity in isolation of the consumer. We need to focus, not in isolation, we need to engage, adapt and be nimble. And mobile can assist with this. I went and visited, I don't know if any of you went on the Nuffield trip to up into Europe, but I went and met with Eric Reed. He worked for Moy Park, which was a very big poultry producer up there. And he left the business and went beef farming. So I went and saw him, and he was collecting huge amounts of data, right down to the temperature of his beef cattle daily on their eyeball, so that he could see which ones had a temperature. And when I said to him, he's doing it all manually, and I turned to him and I said, wow, it's amazing how much data you're collecting. He bluntly turned to me and he said, there's nothing amazing about collecting data. Collecting data is just the basics. So we've got to remember that. So I'll leave you with this. Liebig's law of the minimum states that we can only grow as much as our most limiting factor. Do you know what your most limiting factor is in your business? And could you use mobile to identify and continually improve that? I think we need to now think about investing. You know, we spend millions of dollars on genetics, on development, on animal health, but our opportunity at the moment isn't our most limiting factor is data collection and our ability to use that to make decisions. So we must, as an industry, start investing in mobile technology, because that will enable us to connect the farmer all the way through on one platform. So to ensure that the end of my presentation is explosive, I want to thank my sponsors with a few pictures of my farm in the background in my life.